Good morning, it's time to begin. I welcome all of you and share a few announcements as we get started here this morning. Tom is feeling better, but now Dan and Don aren't feeling too well. And Nellie's feeling a little bit better, but not real good. And I can tell by the look on Betty's face, she's still not feeling 100%. And Ron was supposed to have announcements this morning, but he passed them off to Keith because he's flirting with a cold.
My mom and dad are here because they have to.
All right. We've got a lot of folks in that category. And add to that list, Margie Moore had to go back in the hospital for more surgery, and that was done, and we're hoping that that will take care of the problem and that she'll be much better in the days to come, so keep her and the family in your prayers. And she's at St. Elizabeth's in Boardman. Hey, have any idea how long she'll be there, did they say?
No, she had that rupture and, at this point, they're talking Tuesday, probably check it out to make sure it's not still leaking, so I don't know how much longer they'll keep her out there.
And again, Margie and Dan's daughter, Tricia, is right there by Pam. She's with us today. It's making the best of a bad situation. Pam loves to have Trish visit, but they wish it was under better circumstances. But also, in our prayers, let's remember Don and Shirley Davis. Both of them are sick, and Don, of course, is at Shepherd of the Valley. And Marion Scott, as she continues to recover from knee replacement surgery. And I did talk to Marlene Martin, and she sounded like about as good as she sounded in a long, long time. So hopefully they will be here with us this morning. And one other announcement, Mary Jones passed away yesterday, the mother to Marge Ellen, Marion Scott, Dick Jones, and honestly, there's a third sister, three girls, I can't remember the other daughter's name. And they don't know funeral details yet, it just happened yesterday, so they would, they have asked me to do the funeral, and I think they would like to have a meal. I asked Marge that, and she said that would be wonderful if it was possible. So I don't have details on that, but if there's any way that much of our ladies could kind of put your heads together and give a little forethought to that. I don't know if the funeral happened on, if the passing happened on Saturday. I would think maybe Tuesday or Wednesday, perhaps Thursday at latest, but, and I think all of their family is in town, so anyway, and we may have to juggle some things. We're supposed to have a simple supper Wednesday, but if that ends up that the funeral was going to be Wednesday afternoon or something. Anyway, I'll leave that into the hands of you ladies, but if there's any way that any of you that could help out, and we are kind of shorthanded with ailments and snowbirds being gone and stuff, so anybody that could kind of put your heads together would be greatly appreciated. Marge and Marion mean a lot to us here. We want to help out if we can. And we can. Any other announcements? All right, let's begin with a word of prayer. And Fred, would you lead us, please?
Lord, great Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord, for allowing us to come here and to worship. We give praise to you in all things and remember you in our hearts and our walks in life. And thank you, Lord, for this opportunity and pray we use it to benefit everyone we come in touch with. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 3. And I'll say by way of, I don't know that I would have to say this, but By design, part of this study is going to be a little bit repetitive or redundant. And that really is intentional because from week to week, we will overlap on some ideas and then we may pick up the next week and expand a little bit more or at least review. And that's one good way of learning. So I'm not really apologizing for that. Sometimes we're just slow of heart or slow of mind, and we can hear a point, but we need it emphasized a little bit more, so that's part of the purpose of being repetitive. Let's talk today about the baptism of John, and I know we've talked about that in a sermon for a few weeks, actually. John chapter 3. We'll read a couple of verses at the beginning, and then we'll jump ahead to verse 13. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." For this is the one referred to by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, or make his path straight." And then it says, John himself had a garment of camel's hair and a leather belt about his waist, and his food was locust and wild honey. Then all Jerusalem was going out to him, and all Judea, and all the district around the Jordan, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. Not that the next few verses aren't important, as he stands up against the scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees, but verse 13, Jesus arrived from Galilee at Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, "I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answering said to him, "Permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he permitted him, and after being baptized, Jesus went up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and coming upon him, and behold, a voice out of the heavens saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." So our opening question today, when did we first read about baptism in the New Testament? It's right here, isn't it? In the opening pages of the Synoptic Gospels, and actually John's Gospel could be included in that, with the arrival of John the Baptizer. Now, as we said in a sermon series a couple of years ago, baptism, the idea of washings and immersions, was common in purification rituals for the Jews, and baptism was a common practice among the Jews as a means for a Gentile to become a proselyte. And that simply, proselyte simply means a Gentile who wanted to commit himself to Jehovah God and be in alliance with Judaism, he would undergo a proselyte baptism, and it was an immersion. So now John comes on the scene, and he begins to preach baptism, but what's the twist to it? Is it just a baptism for Gentiles who want to come into Israel's spiritual things? We just read, who was it for?
But it wants to come out of Jerusalem. That it was coming to his baptism.
Well, it was for all of Judea, all of Jerusalem, it was for all of God's people. And if we laid side by side Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and gathered, had time this morning to... Anybody know what I mean when I say a harmony of the Gospels? It's a really nice book to have. I don't use it as much as I should, but sometimes it can be a really helpful thing. It's the four Gospels in columns, side by side. It really makes it handy when you study a subject like this because You've got one column that's Matthew's account, Mark's, Luke's, John, and they're all side by side. And of course, sometimes one of the Gospels, like Mark, is quite a bit shorter, and he doesn't tell us much of anything about the birth, so there's just a blank space in that column when you're reading about the birth of Christ from Matthew and Luke. But if we were to see four records of the preaching of John, John was preaching to the Jews. He was calling all of Israel to come to the Jordan and be baptized. And so this proved to be unsettling to the Jews because of the ramifications of it. They had no trouble sitting on their high horse looking down at the Gentiles saying, yes, you need to undergo a purification rite in order to be in good standing with God. But for someone to come on the scene and tell them, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and to call on them to be baptized. And again, it says here, permitted at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. This passage doesn't say it, but if we look at, here's where Mark's brief gospel, let's go to Mark chapter 1. Because Mark is about as straightforward as any of the gospel writers to tell us the essence of John's message. We call him John the Baptist, or I prefer to call him John the Baptizer, because he was not a member of the Baptist Church, as you know. He was a baptizer, and that's the term Baptist as well. Verse 4. John, Mark 1, verse 4. John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea was coming out to him, and all the people of Jerusalem, and they were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, when it says all, don't read that in the sense that everybody in Judea and Jerusalem agreed with this, because as I just mentioned, there were a lot of people among Judaism, especially the more high-minded scribes and Pharisees, who dug their heels in and weren't about to be baptized by John, and probably the main reason was, we don't need to be baptized. What do we need to repent of? We're paragons of virtue, and we are the ones that show the Gentiles how to live. Comments or questions, Burdett?
I like what you said, Jerry, about the fact that they were coming because they weren't coming because they didn't think they needed to repent of anything.
Yeah.
And I think that was important. The message I get from this morning, and it's the same with our life group study for tonight, is the fact that he is sending the message, the kingdom of God is near. And this is what Jesus told those who were sent out in Luke chapter 10 and also in chapter 9, when he sent the 12. He told them to tell the people that the kingdom of God is near.
Yeah.
And that's important because I don't know that they could really understand coming to a change and saying to them, who were loyal Jews, saying to them, the kingdom of God is near. And because they thought they had the kingdom of God.
Well, this was a time of great anticipation for the nation of Israel as a whole. And as you remember, they had their scriptures, and the last piece of that scripture was an Old Testament book called the Book of Malachi. And since it had been written, it had been like 400 years since God had authored another prophecy speaking to the nation of Israel. So it's not only an anxiety as to, the prophet said, my people perish for lack of vision. And we sometimes use that word vision to think, well, it's poor planning on our part. But really the best translation of that is, my people, God says, my people perish for lack of revelation. In other words, God hasn't spoken to them, and they're in dire straits. So 400 years without hearing from God, and then the last book that was written, the book of Malachi, the prophecy of Malachi, spoke about one that God would raise up in the spirit of Elijah, who would come on the scene. And so when John came on the scene, he looked like Elijah, he sounded like Elijah, and everything about the prophecy of Malachi seemed to be summed up in John the Baptizer. So this stirred quite an enthusiasm among the people of Israel, thinking, finally, maybe it's time that our Messiah is going to arrive, because it looks like Elijah has come to prepare the way in the form of John the Baptizer. Now, as I said, a lot of the people were coming out to John to be baptized, but there were those leaders. And how did John speak to them? Give me a couple images of things that he said to them.
He called them a brood of vipers.
He called them a brood of vipers. Is that necessarily bad? Jeannie tells a story. Mark, maybe you can relate this since Jeannie's not in here. Where Ma Helms lived in Texas, I believe it was, and she went out on the back porch for something. There was a bunch of snakes. Anyway, she came out.
There was a snake under the house, and she got the shotgun and shot the snake.
Yeah.
Shotgun, not her,
Kind of shot the smithereens out of that thing, is the way I understood it. She came out with a shotgun on a snake or snakes and just started firing away. Well, okay, so how many of you really like snakes? Trisha, do you like snakes?
No?
I don't know too many of us that are thrilled. I talked about these survivalist shows where they always say, we got to get up off the ground. And I always think in my mind, you mean a snake can't crawl up a little skinny tree and get into a little hammock they made? I never quite understand how protected that is. I guess it's from ants and bugs, and, or at least a little better protection, but not too many of us, very rare, would it be the person that says, I'd love to wake up with a snake crawling around my neck in the morning.
Snake likes on our shoes.
You do, Meg?
No, snakes get shoes.
Oh, okay. You don't mind walking on them. Well, okay, so brood of vipers, and he said to them, the axe is already laid at the root of the tree. And that's just saying that you're about to come down. You're on your way down. And so that inflamed, that's like, and as we mentioned in the sermon and in other settings, John didn't pull any punches. He was not politically correct in any way. If he had a speechwriter, they would have said to him, oh, don't say that. Then you'd really get him upset if you say that. John was just as plain spoken as could be, telling the people exactly what God had told him. So, we got to move along here. So baptism first came on the scene when John began to preach. And how did he baptize?
By immersion.
How do we know that for that? All we know to this point, all we know to this point is that he baptized in the Jordan. Now, we've all seen movies where people wade down in the water and you reach up and you sprinkle. So how do we know that he baptized by immersion? Couple reasons. We're dead?
No, go ahead.
No, I'm open to it. Help me develop it here. First of all, the word itself. Somebody tell me something about that.
Baptism.
The word baptize comes from a Greek word that means to immerse. There's another Greek word that means to sprinkle. This is the word that means to immerse. That alone should settle it. But then we've got a passage in John chapter 3. Do I give you that in your notes? John chapter 3 and verse 23. Again, someone read that for us and think about it in light of immersion versus sprinkling. John 3, 23. Verse 1 there, I'm going to give you a little green tiger.
Now John also was baptized in Aenon near Salem because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized.
All right. Baptism, the word itself is enough, but here, how would you explain that to somebody? He was baptizing at Aenon near Salem because there was much water there. Do you need much water to sprinkle somebody?
No, not sprinkling.
Not much water at all. So why would John note in his gospel the location of John's baptismal pool if it was, you know, not even worth noting? I mean, John could baptize anywhere on the river, but he had to find a spot where it was adequate. And I grew up in Ashtabula for a number of years, and for the most part, the Ashtabula River is not a deep river. And you would be hard-pressed to find a lot of spots in the Ashtabula River where it was adequate for baptism. There ended up being one that where we swam. It's called the Ford. Some of you have driven across it. And it's just about waist-deep or up to your chest. And it would be if I was John the Baptizer, that's where I would set up shop, because you could actually immerse somebody there with no difficulty. All right, so baptism comes on the scene, and John is baptizing. People are flocking to him, except for the leaders, and they're resisting him. They're coming to him to be baptized. He's baptizing them he's calling on them to repent, and he's baptizing them for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus comes to him and says, I want to be baptized. So what did John say? Josh, you weren't here when we read the text. Do you know what John said? What would you say if Jesus came to you and asked you to baptize him?
I would do it.
You would do it? Yeah. Well, John's first thing was, you're coming to me and asking me to baptize you? I should be asking you to baptize me. And John had said on one day, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So John was aware of the nature of Jesus, that he was sent by God to be the Messiah and the Savior. But Jesus came to John to be baptized. Now, we've asked this recently, but I really want you to get this in your mind, because I think that we have been pretty fuzzy on this over the years as to how would you respond to our next question. Did Jesus come? Was Jesus baptized? First of all, what's the answer? Yes, he was. But the more difficult question is, why was Jesus baptized? And Nellie told us a couple of weeks ago, right out of that Mark chapter 1 and verse 4, or right out of Matthew's account, to fulfill all righteousness. That's why Jesus was baptized. But that's one of those things that, when somebody says that, your eyes kind of glaze over, like, what does that mean? To fulfill all righteousness. Does it say somewhere in the Old Testament that Jesus was going to be baptized? What does it mean to fulfill all righteousness? Anybody want to elaborate on that? It's not that hard of a concept, but Burdette?
Yeah.
Gail?
When Jesus started preaching,
one
of his messages was, if we've been baptized in John's baptism, but you weren't,
okay, so it was exemplary. All right, what I'm driving at here, Jesus came to John to be baptized. What was it? Just a a politically correct move, kind of like relating to the people so that they'll think I'm one of them or whatever? Or was this real? In the sense of, yes, he was really baptized, but I guess the question I'm driving at was, did Jesus need to be baptized?
Yes.
By John?
Yes.
Burdette, what do you base that on?
I base it on the fact that Jesus said this back to John, that the things that you are doing, he says, it must be done because you have to carry out the requirements of God. And I take that in my Bible here.
Okay.
He's carrying out the requirements of God. You mentioned righteousness a minute ago. To be able to be righteous in the sight of God, you must be able to respond to His will and what He has set up and requires for us to do.
Okay. Behind the scenes here is a passage that you've heard us quote now about a million times over the last month. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 17. He had to be made like his brethren in all things in order to become our propitiation or our high priest to bring about forgiveness. If somebody's looking at that, make sure I've got the right passage because I'm not looking at my notes here.
Yeah,
okay. So he had to be made like his brethren in all things. So John comes calling all of his brethren to be baptized. Jesus has come down to earth, and he has become like one of the Jews. He is one of the Jews. And in every sense, he is a part of that Jewish climate or that Jewish culture. But there's a third point here that maybe we don't think about it chronologically until we get to the time of the cross. Here again, read 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21. Someone read that for us. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21.
For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sake, so that we can be made right with God through Christ.
All right, now, Burdette, I do like that translation most of the time, but I don't like that one.
You don't like that one?
Because it says, God made Jesus, who did not sin, to be the offering for our sin. They're afraid to say what is so strong here that we have tended to shy away from it. What's being said there, and I would back this up with other passages, God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf. So did Jesus need to go to John to be baptized? God made him to be sin on our behalf. In our minds, we might think, well, that only took place for a few hours on the cross one day. And that's certainly the culmination of it. But all of Jesus' life was a journey towards that. So when Jesus came to John, he was one of the Jews, and God had made him to be sin. So he went into the water to be baptized by John. I don't know if you think that's heretical or if you think that's right on. Comments or questions? If you don't tie in that verse with it, Paul says in Galatians that Jesus became a curse for us. If you don't weave those verses into this narrative, it almost comes across like a little bit of a charade. I don't really need to be baptized. I'm perfect in every way. And this is the way we've read it. But just to placate the masses or to blend in with the crowd or to fulfill all righteousness. And Paul goes on to say, now let me quote the rest of that 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And that ties in with this fulfill all righteousness. Fred?
The problem is, if what was after he was baptized, he was sinless, I mean, from that point on, see, it's all mind-boggling.
It is mind-boggling.
But he took our sins. I look at he had to be an example to us totally to show what not to do or how not to be, you know. But it seems like that was fulfilling prophecy, that he would be baptized as an example that we all could be baptized.
I think part of the fulfillment to fulfill all righteousness was in keeping with the words from Isaiah, which we'll refer to in the sermon today, about how Jesus had such a humble beginning. And really that's the prophecies that the writer of Hebrews is reflecting on when he says what he does in Hebrews 2:17. He had to be made like his brethren in all things. And this was part of being made like his brethren, was being put on an equal level with them.
He felt all of our sin, and basically he was tempted in all ways that we had been tempted, but that doesn't give him sin. He didn't.
Yeah, it is mind-boggling. Because on the one hand, Scripture says that yet without sin, Jesus lived his life yet without sin. But on the other hand, God made him sin on our behalf. He becomes, as Burnett's translation says, the offering for us. And the only way he becomes that offering is because of his obedient life.
Can he become sin?
Well, that must be possible, Maggie, because otherwise he himself didn't sin, but he came to represent all of us in our sinfulness.
But it says he became sin when to be sin, or whatever that
is. God made him to be sin. God saw in Jesus an offering that could atone for all of our sin. So the life of Jesus, lived in perfect obedience, would become the offering. He would sum up all of our sinfulness, but because of his obedience, God would smile upon the offering. Nellie?
When a man has, first of all, that he's showing his sinfulness, that Christ was also mankind. We're not of this world, but we're in this world. Does that make sense? And it is, when we're baptized, we are sinners. And when we go down and we're baptized, when we come out, we are a new creature. Mm-hmm. Am I right?
I think you're right, Nellie. You're just running a little ahead of our wagon train here. We're gonna come to that. Stay with me for right now for just a little bit. We're just talking about the baptism of Jesus. And as you see later on, we're gonna ask, and this is gonna carry over for next week, why do we need to be baptized? We're gonna get to that. What about our baptism? Right now I'm just trying to analyze why Jesus was baptized. And yes, that is, we could all look at Jesus and say, well, if Jesus needed to be baptized, then I need to be baptized. But it's really helpful to understand what drove Jesus to be baptized. And that was that he took on our full humanity.
Could he be an example to us that nobody can live on this earth without sin? Not even Jesus.
Well, I don't know.
He had no sin. But this is something that us as people have to, you know, that's Jesus, it's not us.
But Jesus did live without sin.
No, he had
right.
lived without sin. I think we think of sin we think sin is an action. Obviously, Jesus did not participate, did not do any action with sinning, but he had sin. I think there's a difference between having sin, like Jesus, and sinning, like Jesus did not, and we do.
See, part of our trouble here, and it's probably part of the teacher's trouble in being able to articulate this in a better way. Part of the concept of 2 Corinthians 5:21, that's a judicial decision on the part of God. It's a legal thing. It's a law thing. Somebody had to atone for the sins of the people. So God worked out a way to where he could forgive all of us, but the only way that he could forgive all of us was that if Jesus would bear our burdens and become sin on our behalf. So that's a legality, but in real everyday life, Jesus did not sin. But on the legal books, over here it says, oh, he's the one. He's the one that will become the curse. And in him, all sin will be personified. That's God's way of reckoning, and Paul uses that word reckoning, which is kind of a legal term too. Stephen?
When I struggle with this concept sometimes too. Generally what I find helping us remember that in the Old Testament times, every year it would be a land, right?
Yeah.
They would take a land and say, okay, this land here, all the sins of the children of Israel are on this land.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we know that, you know, animals do not sin.
Yeah.
So therefore, you know, they don't have a lot to go by. So therefore, a lot of times that's what happened with Jesus, where God said, okay, all these sins I'm putting on you.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, everyone else will be forgiven.
There's two images here. Stephen's referring to the scapegoat idea, and Jesus did become the scapegoat for our sins, but he also became the lamb that laid on the altar that was sacrificed on our behalf. Burdette, last word.
Yeah. This helps me when I go to Hebrews chapter 5. Because I've had a hard time through the years understanding Christ being half of the order of Melchizedek. Okay? But when you see this, and when you get down there in chapter 5, where God says, you are my son. Today I have become your father. And then he goes on and when it talks about the rest of the chapter, you're going to have to read the whole thing, but he also goes on over that Christ did these things, and even though Christ was God's son, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. So it was needed that Christ would suffer and go through all of these trials for us.
Very good. Now look, next week we'll pick up on this, and I want to clarify a little bit more. Why did John come on the scene? What was his role? This is an interesting question, and I want you to research it based on our notes here. Did Jesus preach baptism? Think about that for next Sunday. And finally, I didn't mean to cut you short. You're on to the heart of what this class is all about. Because we're not just here to study about the history of John or what Jesus did, but we want to know how does that impact us. So we're coming to that, we're going to emphasize that a great deal throughout the next few weeks. So just bear with us on that. You're ahead of the pack. You're a trailblazer on that regard. You're going where I'm going, but I don't want to go there just yet. And finally, I want us to think about next week, what's the difference between John's baptism and Jesus' baptism? Just come back to class ready to talk about that. Thank you.